is the Panasonic S5 Mark II now a viable option for wildlife photography? This last 5 to 6 weeks, I've been testing it against the Canon R7 to see just how well it stacks up. And in today's video, we're going to be looking at my results. Now, before we go too much further, a few criteria. Number one, I'm not testing every single variable of these cameras. There is too much packed into them to do that. And this has been a 5 to 6 week test already. Number two, not every test is going to be a one for one comparison. I'm testing these how I would use these cameras in the field myself, which is mostly shooting as wide open as I can and mostly at the very long end. Number three, keep in mind that these cameras are very different cameras. One features a full frame sensor and the other is an APS-C sensor, and both have their pros and their cons. And finally, this isn't a slight against any brand. I am not interested in brand wars. And I know this sounds harsh, but I don't really care what camera you like the most or whatever. Cameras shouldn't sort of be your identity. But this might be a useful tool for anybody looking to make a decision in the future. Now, need a bit of context. Firstly, I love Panasonic cameras. However, as I've sort of progressed into a real passion for wildlife photography, it's not a professional pursuit, it's a passion. Those cameras were originally not very good for wildlife photography. Why? Well, obviously they had that infamous contrast detect autofocus, which is good in some situations, but not so much for wildlife shooting. This all came to a head because essentially I went to Brown Sea Island carrying a real heavy setup. I was carrying the Sigma 150-600, I had the Panasonic S1, I got really fatigued, and to sort of pour salt into the wound, I didn't have very many keeper photos. So when I got back, I got the R7, I got a RF 100-400 and an RF 600. Now those lenses I'd been quite dismissive of because I didn't think that the build quality would be very good. However, where they lack in build quality and weather sealing, they were very, very light, and I liked the results that my friend was getting from his camera. So I got those I got that system and that setup. And then a few months later, Panasonic announced the S5 Mark II, and it finally had phase detect autofocus. And for a long, long time, it didn't phase me at all, because I kind of thought, well, I'm fine with the R7. Then you get a bit bored, you get a bit of wandering eye, and honestly, as good as those lenses are, they're quite slow, and more importantly to me, they haven't got weather sealing. So I started looking at other lenses. Now, the 100-500 is kind of a legendary lens at this point, but it's massively expensive. It's out of my price range. I waited for this 200-800, and this was supposed to be their affordable lens, also out of my price range. I don't think it's affordable. It might be for you, but it definitely isn't for me. I do not think that is a cheap sort of middle of the way sort of lens at all. I think they failed that assignment, but I do think the lens is awesome. I don't want to go into Sony. They've got great sort of cameras and lenses and lots of options, but it's money to do that. So I went back to looking at Panasonic cameras, and I originally had the Sigma 100-400, traded that for the 150-600, and then obviously I traded it all in to get the R7. I reached out to some mates and they lent me the Sigma 100-400 DGDN F5-F6.3, which I'm pitting against the RF 100-400 F5.6-F8. And that's what this video is all about. Can the S5II keep up with the R7? Is there actual real world improvement in this new autofocus system? Now, my first testing, we are looking at a wildlife park in the Cotswolds. I just needed to calibrate with the camera. That day went really well, apart from I made a bunch of mistakes and I wasn't particularly smooth. My girlfriend has helped me out for all these tests. She's been shooting on the R7 and I've been doing the S5II so we can save time. On this particular day, I was just calibrating. I was just setting up the camera how I liked it. And as I said, I made some mistakes, particularly getting motion blur because I wasn't shooting at high enough shutter speeds and all sorts of silly things. I really wanted to push these cameras in these situations. I want to see what they're like shooting through objects, because that's a real test and challenge for an autofocus system, for any autofocus system. And it did pretty well. I come away with a few good photos, but I needed to construct some more sound testing. So I come up with the following categories, and I'll see if I can remember them all. I wanted to see what the autofocus was like in terms of acquisition, in terms of tracking. I wanted to see what the burst mode was like, what the buffer was like as well, the image stabilization, low light performance, noise performance. And I think I then wanted to just go out and have a mess around and see how I got on with the cameras. So after that first round of testing, I went out, and the easiest test to do was a sharpness test. So I found a church wall shot wide open. This is with the Sigma and the S5II combo. So the Sigma, DGDN, etc., etc., and the Panasonic S5II, wide open at 100 millimeters. And I think this looks reasonably sharp. I think it's probably better than average, actually. It's nice. There's nothing wrong with this. However, when I punched into 400 millimeters, it is noticeably softer, and this is not the best performance, in my opinion, unfortunately, from the Sigma lens. Now, when I stopped down to f8, things improved drastically, and it looked really, really good. But obviously, one of the reasons I'm looking at shooting back into sort of Panasonic is moving up to sort of better lenses, in regards to having better weather sealing and faster lenses. Faster meaning letting more light in. So I'd idealistically want to be shooting wide open at 6.3 and not stopping down to f8. Onto the RF 100 to 400. Well, first, we've got to take note of equivalence. And equivalence is basically, we're looking at the crop factor of the sensor, which is an APS-C 1.6 times sensor, so it's a 1.6 times crop factor that you apply to your field of view, your depth of field, and your noise performance. So we should expect that the APS-C sensor, being a smaller sensor and having those sort of letting less light in, should perform worse than a full frame sensor in terms of low light performance and depth of field, etc., etc. So this lens on this system is the equivalent of a 160 to 640. And wide open, this looks really sharp. And if we crop in, again, it looks sharp. There's not much to talk about. It's a very, very sharp lens. And when we punch all the way in, it's sharp all the way through the range, from corner, from center to corner, really good, and noticeably sharper than the Sigma. So why is this? Well, I don't necessarily think that the Sigma lens isn't as sharp. I think what is actually happening is, because we are using a smaller sensor, the noise performance and the fact that we are using the sharpest part of the lens, because it is a lens designed for a full frame camera, is resulting in a sharper image. And that noise will also give the impression of sharpness. If you ever get a soft photo, if you want it to look a bit sharper, you can add a very fine grain over it in the edit, and it will give the impression it is a sharper photo. But the win goes to the R7 in terms of sharpness, because yes, I think the Sigma, which is behind me, might be sharper. I'd have to test it on an APS-C camera, but to my eyes, it's not under these conditions and with these combination of cameras. Next, obviously, I think the one a lot of you are waiting for is, how good is the autofocus? Well, the R7 uses animal eye autofocus, meaning it will latch onto the eye, and it's got a lot of modes set up in the camera that you can tinker with to get the best performance. And I think it did a really, really good job, as expected. It's not a perfect camera. The sensor's quite slow, so essentially you can kind of miss focus sometimes. And this is quite a well-known problem. It doesn't affect me as much as I think it has other people, and I think that's because I'm very good at tinkering with my camera and changing settings and just getting used to things very quickly. The Panasonic S5II, on the other hand, it has an animal detect mode, which will draw boxes around the subject. And honestly, in terms of focus acquisition, they're both really, really good. I was going to give the win to the R7, but on one of the days where I took these cameras out separately, the S5II seemed to be picking things up a bit faster. One of the many sort of jaw-dropping conclusions I had throughout this, which was, wow, how is this camera picking up subjects as well as my R7? Now, holding those subjects was a different story. I think the R7 was still doing a better job of, once latched onto a subject, keeping the subject there. So I kind of want to give a tie in terms of focus acquisition, but I've noticed it's at different distances that performance can change. So there's a lot of grey area. I'm going to give the acquisition a tie, and I'm going to give the sort of ability to hold focus to the R7. Now, we want to couple this with the fact that both cameras will be shooting animals, which means we're shooting in a burst mode. Burst mode means you hold the shutter down and it takes photos very quickly, continuously. With the S5II, I was able to get 200 photos in a row without taking my finger off the button. Now, with the R7, I was able to get 119 photos. So I'm going to give the point to the S5 Mark II. However, it is important to note that the R7 was able to write those photos to the memory card a little bit faster. The R7 can actually shoot 15 frames per second in mechanical and 30 frames per second in electronic. However, the jello effect is horrendous. So when I say jello effect, what I'm talking about is rolling shutter. Rolling shutter refers to how fast the sensor reads from top to bottom when recording a photo, and because it's quite slow in the R7, I find I rarely actually shoot at 30 frames a second. I tend to shoot below 30 in electronic or at 15 frames a second mechanical, and I'm fine with that. Those speeds are very, very good. Now, the S5II can only do like 7 frames per second in mechanical, but it can shoot a pretty remarkable 30 frames per second in electronic. So which camera had the best rolling shutter performance? The S5II did, by a landslide. I'm really surprised by how well it did. How I tested this was I found a tree and I just panned left to right really scientifically. And this is the result from the R7. This was the worst of the bunch, and it looks really bad. Look at the bottom of the image. Look how distorted that is. Versus the S5II, which looks really good. It's got much better control over that image than the R7 does. What does this mean? Well, this is one of the huge revelations here. It means that you can shoot 30 frames per second in your S5II, which is blackout free. I couldn't see any blackout anyway, and have better rolling shutter performance. And we can couple that with our previous results, which I've already talked about, the autofocus working really, really well. So I give this win to the S5 Mark II. I keep looking down. I've got my S5 here and I've got my R7 over here. So the next test I wanted to test was low light. Quite a simple test. All I did was obviously went to that same church. It was really, really dark day, and I just took photos on both and brought them up to correct exposure in post. This is the R7, looks horrendous, and this is the S5II, it looks much better. I brought the R7 up by 2 stops and the S5II up by 4 stops, if I remember correctly, and it looks far cleaner, even at higher ISOs. And how should you feel about this? Nothing really, because all I did was add denoise and I got this result. It's simple. Yes, it's one extra thing in post, but it's great. Nothing to worry about. I think technology is sort of meeting the sort of demand where there are failings in cameras. So denoising technology being one of those things that's evolved massively in the last few years. Next up, I think we went back to Cotswolds, but this time to Birdland. This time I knew what I was doing, and I wanted to do that same test again, shooting through cages. Another jaw-dropping moment. It was just locking on and locking on and locking on. Really, really great job. And these are just a selection of photos I got from throughout the day, and I'll show up some R7 photos that my girlfriend got as well, just so you got an idea of the sort of images you can get. So needless to say, I was really impressed with this. But it's also really important to see how these cameras work in the real world. So I took the S5II with the 100-400 to a bird hide and did what I'd usually do, which is just a good session in the bird hide, taking photos. And I think they got some voodoo going on because I swear it just keep getting, every time I pick the camera up, it keeps getting better and better. And even though it's only putting squares around the subject, more often than not, it was razor sharp on the eye. Like, fantastic. I come away with some great results. And I'm purposely trying to shoot around objects that are quite complex or difficult to shoot through. The way I personally shoot my, have my autofocus set up is I prefer to have the wide area, then I hold the thumbnail down and I can have a pinpoint mode. I do the same on the R7 as well. When I took the R7 out to the hide, weirdly and a bit disappointingly, it was struggling to get a photo of a kingfisher. However, granted, the kingfisher was not within sort of optimal working distance with any of the lenses I was using, but I did think it would be able to snap on, and it wasn't. And even some of the birds that were closer, it kind of narrowed the gap between the differences between these two cameras. And I kind of think, in terms of like snapping on, my mind was starting to skew a bit, but I still think the R7 just about pips it. So let's move on to some of the features of these cameras itself, because I think in terms of all those testing, I think, you know, we're pretty level pegging. The conclusion in a nutshell from that is, yes, of course, the S5II is capable of keeping up. But what about the rest of the settings? Well, the R7 has pretty good handling, although I think I'd give the win to the S5II. It's a more solid camera. It's got better customization as well, so I'd give the win for customization to the S5II. I would give wildlife specific, like a sort of bonus round, I've got to give it to the R7 because of that amazing pre-burst mode, which means you can keep your shutter down and it will keep taking photos, and any photo you take before you've fully pressed your shutter will be stored in the camera. In terms of the lenses, then I think the Sigma is a better lens in terms of being more feature-packed. It's got focus limiters, it's got multiple image stabilization modes. You might have a custom button on there as well. In terms of the RF, I think it's only got like a lock really and an autofocus manual focus switch. Pretty bare bones. However, in terms of handling, I would give the handling to the RF lens. In terms of image quality, I'd give the Sigma the win. I think it's got slightly better image quality, nicer depth of field, more roll off, as you would expect for a lens with a 6.3 aperture on the long end versus an f8. Obviously, we talked about sharpness and that goes to the RF. In terms of versatility and handling, I prefer the RF. It's super lightweight and it's really easy to bring around. It's always a pleasure. You can carry it for hours and hours at a time. And in terms of overall, which lens I think is best, it's kind of a tie because the F8 might be slow, but as I said, I could be out for hours with that lens getting shots I just wouldn't with the Sigma. So it's kind of a tie. You've got one lens which is really light and versatile, albeit not weather sealed, and you've got one more fully featured lens that's going to get you slightly nicer photos, and it does come with the safety of weather sealing as well. So you can draw your own conclusions on what you think is best, but I like them both. They're both useful. Now, some other cool things that I think are worth mentioning is battery power. That goes to the R7. It annihilates the S5II. It lasts so long with the official battery. It lasts two batteries will last me pretty much all day doing photos and videos. Phenomenal performance. In terms of customization, I think I touched on this a minute ago. I want to go back to it because the S5II annihilates the R7 in this regard. The R7 is not a very intuitive camera to set up, in my opinion. The S5II is very intuitive. If you want to change or customize a button on the S5II, hold it down for a few seconds and it will give you a list of options. It's not as simple in the R7. In terms of video mode, the S5II annihilates the R7 again. It doesn't really annihilate it. They've both got log modes, they can both do HLG, and they both do really good performance, but the V-log on the S5II is much easier to work with. So if you want to do some proper good wildlife filmmaking like to the best that the camera can offer, then it goes to the S5II. However, the R7 can shoot in 4K 60 without a crop as well. And if you do want to shoot in a log or HLG file and you're willing to put in the time, you're going to get similar results, but it is less forgiving. There's less room, less margin for error there. So the win for video goes to the S5II. Image stabilization in the cameras, the S5II is much better. Image stabilization in the lenses, I'd give the win to the RF. I didn't expect to, but I think it's got 6 stops versus 4, and that was evident in the photos. So where does this leave me? Well, I would like to move to more professional lenses in the future. However, on Canon, those lenses are just too expensive, especially in comparison to other camera systems. For example, the Sony cameras, you can get the 200 to 600. You can get it for £1,000 if you buy it used. That's such a good lens as well, versus almost £3,000 for the 100 to 500 on the Canon system. And that lens also has problems with if you attach a teleconverter, which is really frustrating. I think a little bit annoying. Needless to say though, the actual image quality is great and it's small and it's lightweight. I also waited for the 200 to 800, which I thought would be their affordable sort of lens I would be able to graduate to, but it's not really, if we're being honest with ourselves. A middle sort of range lens should be about 1500, and this is over in the UK, this is like 2300. It's just not a real viable option for me personally. Great lens, again, great focal distance, but not for me because of that price. So you look at Panasonic, a camera system which I think unfortunately is quite overlooked. You've got 4 lenses from Sigma, and I think at some point I might go for that Sigma 150 to 600. It's also worth mentioning throughout all these tests, if you put different lenses on, it's going to affect your autofocus performance and it's going to improve it and whatnot. And Sigma lenses have improved iteration after iteration, but that 150 to 600 is a heavy lens, but it's great image quality, fast autofocus, it's a reasonable price as well. And on Panasonic cameras, you can shoot at full 30 frames per second with a teleconverter as well, which you can't do on Sony. And you should feel confident now, if you're a Panasonic owner, to go out and grab that lens or any of Sigma's lenses and start your wildlife photography or filming journey. It's a real, true, viable option. For me, I'm keeping hold of my R7 because I've chose option 3. There was a curveball in all this. A sort of dream opportunity come up, which is a real great deal come up on a safari trip. Something I thought I'd only be doing as like some old dude when I'm like retired. And we just couldn't say no to it. And throughout this whole experience, my girlfriend has been helping. She's been helping me take all the photos on the R7, well, when we've been out at like, wildlife parks. And it's really helped sort of make the testing a bit easier. And I actually really enjoyed those trips out to those parks. It was a hell of a lot of fun just seeing her take those photos. And this is what photography is all about, experiences. So the curveball made me go with option 3, which is I actually brought her a Canon R50, a camera with not a huge buffer, but it has a really good burst rate. It has fantastic autofocus and it's got a lot of good video features in. And it's the camera that I'm filming this video with right now. So I wanted to save my money, put it towards that trip and use a small fraction of it to get her this camera so that when we go on this trip, that 600 f11 will be on one camera and the 100 to 400 will be on the other. So we don't have to change lenses and get dust in our cameras. But fundamentally, we are going to have a great experience. And that means so much more to me than any lens or tech spec ever could. I hope you've enjoyed today's video. I hope it's been informative. Let me know which camera you would go for in the comments below. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button if you've managed to make it through this whole video. Catch you next time.